Hello everyone, number one Marmaduke fan here. I am once again asking for your support as I read a whole bunch of mangas. All right, we're gonna try to get through three volumes of Delicious in Dungeon today. Real quick, the unreviewable comic, case closed. It's perfect. How can I talk about it? It's a bunch of murder mysteries. Actually, I was gonna say, nothing ever happens to advance the plots, but there are a couple neat twist-a-roos on the plots. There's a whole murder mystery that Harley Hartwell, King of the Wingmen, tries to solve on his own before Conan gets there, because often Harley, who has a Kansu dialect and is from a different region of Japan, he's a brilliant detective too, but he basically is there to show how brilliant Jimmy is, because Jimmy comes to the correct deduction one step ahead of Harley. So it's kind of neat seeing him on his own as the star for once. I think there's also a murder mystery where Richard Moore is accused, which is a great twist, because Richard Moore and the kid and Conan always show up at these murders and they never get accused of or suspected of it themselves. So there actually are some nice twist-a-roos on the typical Conan plot. Also, Toyama Seimonojo Kagemoto. I've seen this character referenced other times in Japanese media. He's basically like a judge who goes wandering around and investigates the criminal underworld himself personally and has like an epic tattoo. He gets referenced in this in Conan as well. Gosho says, I recommend Toyama no Kinsan Torimonocho, accounts of Toyama no Kinsan's arrests. Have these ever been localized? I'm really into Zatoichi, so I'd actually be interested in getting into some Japanese television outside of anime movies. But anyway, that's volume 31. Okay, Delicious in Dungeon, volumes 7 through 9. So the overarching kind of theme of this series is it started out kind of as a silly gag on Dungeons & Dragons, and it's really evolved into a very deep, well-thought-out, and complicated fantasy story in its own right, where just like the meta gag of eating monsters remains a consistent theme throughout. So thus far, Laios and his gang have been trying to rescue Fallon after seemingly rescuing her and resurrecting her with dark with forbidden magic. They discover that her soul has merged with a dragon soul, so they've kind of made things worse. So in one last desperate effort, they're going even deeper into the dungeon to try to free Fallon from the dragon soul, and see if they can fix the dumb mistakes they've made. Meanwhile, Kabru, a very serious young knight with a chip on his shoulder because monsters killed his parents, has an agenda all of his own. So while Laios' group is fooling around trying to save the sister, Kabru desperately wants to conquer the dungeon and become the king because he believes he could be a competent ruler and deal with the overarching political situation. So how's it all gonna bang out at the end? In the previous volume, their team was joined by a Japanese Neko girl, cat ninja, waifu, and she's very rude and doesn't get along with the others. Later we find out that she basically had no one to bring her up or raise her right, so she's very selfish and kind of bratty. She actually has to kind of consciously remember to earlier in her life when Tade, an oni girl waifu, was nice to her and shared her rice with her. So it's sort of like, while most people know you're supposed to be nice to other people, cat girl basically has to think hard and remember times when people were nice to her, even just to remember what the word nice means. But that doesn't necessarily mean that she wants to be nice to anybody. There's also a great balance where everybody on the team has talents and abilities to complement their weaknesses. So Cat Girl's very acrobatic. She's very good at darting around her opponent, but she doesn't really have any kind of like big attack to land a finishing blow. Or whereas Chilichuk is like 3 feet tall. He has a really cool head and is an engineer, but he just can't fight at all. So it ends up with Chilichuk kind of like firing arrows and desperately trying to run away from the ice golem while giving Cat Girl instructions about how to actually take the thing down. I guess one of the overall strengths of Ryoko Kui is there are little goofy romantic moments. There are lots of great funny comedy moments. Interpersonal moments with the psychology of the characters, and the action is actually very well thought out, exciting, and creative. There's this theme that there's always some trick or clever observation they have to make to overcome the monsters they're fighting. Anyway, cat girl runs off on her own and just doesn't care what the others are doing. You guys fight these wolves. I can't do anything, so I'm just going to go off on her own. And Marcel basically has to have a heart-to-heart with her, where Marcel has to admit, you know, when I started exploring this dungeon, I was disgusted at the idea of eating monsters. I sort of had to overcome a girly problem I had, and I had to do something I didn't want to do in the name of accomplishing a bigger goal. I want to save my friend Fallon, so I have to eat monsters I'm not comfortable eating. You want to free yourself from the cat soul and just be a normal person again. So that means you're going to have to eat food you may not necessarily like, right? So it's sort of like they're trying to teach cat girl how to not behave like a spoiled toddler, because she never had any upbringing throughout her life. I'll just mark this for all of you weebs out there. We meet Kabru, and we see Shortstack dwarf redhead waifu again. So Kabru and the gang have basically just gotten out of the dungeon by the skin of their teeth, and Kabru thinks again about his agenda. His family was killed by monsters. He wants someone who knows what they're doing to conquer the dungeon, and to conquer it before the dungeon grows so dangerous, the dungeon itself actually levels up, that the monsters just pour out and kill everybody. And what they learn is that a elite elf group called the Canaries have arrived. And the elves, because they live to be 1,000 years old, basically they see human beings and other short-lived races as stupid, adorable kids. Where, you know, these toys are way too dangerous for you, so we're the elves, we're the big shots on the world stage, so we'll come in and clean up you stupid kids' mess. Basically, and in fact, they only ever bother dealing with a dungeon when a dungeon becomes dangerous enough that it's close to reaching its final stage and basically turning everybody into zombies and killing each other. There's this really neat thing about the dungeon where, as the dungeon levels up, the treasure gets better and the monsters get tougher. So that actually attracts more adventurers and more people looking to make a living. But then that ironically is pouring them deeper and deeper into a trap that'll kill them. And the Canaries are so elite and so boss that they don't even care about a dungeon until that dungeon reaches level 4. And it's like, oh crap, it's about to go level 5. We got to get there and shut it all down. Now, Kabru doesn't want this to happen because he wants to rule the dungeon. So he's in this really tight spot where he'd like their help, maybe, because they're a really powerful force, but he doesn't want them to conquer the dungeon on his own. So he has to kind of like go introduce himself and sort of politically intrude himself into their group. So he uses things like the fact that he was raised by an elf as an inn. He tries to use his connections and say, hey, I know the local black market guys. Maybe they can help you do this quietly. Why don't we try to do this quietly rather than go in guns blazing? But Kabru is following his own agenda. Kabru doesn't like Laios. He sort of thinks Laios is too stupid to run the kingdom, but he realizes that Laios's group is actually the closest humans have ever got to actually conquering the dungeon. So even though he wants to conquer the dungeon, he'd rather Laios conquer it and it go to humans rather than it goes to elves, and elves continue to secure their I guess they're like the America of the fantasy world, where they're the global superpower. Meanwhile, Laios and his group, as they continue going deeper into the dungeon, face different sort of monstrous challenges. So they're grabbed by a group of ghosts, and they learn that these ghosts are the spirits of the people who used to live on this island before the lunatic magician cast a curse on them all and turned it into a giant dungeon. So the lunatic magician is sort of trapping their souls in this ghostly space where they don't have to eat and they don't age and they just stay there for 1,000 years. It's sort of like the lunatic magician is misguided and thinks he's protecting and preserving the people of his kingdom and his king. They interact with them, and there's some cute stuff like the villagers make fashions because they don't have anything to do, just hanging around as ghosts all day long, and some of their fashions are kind of goofy. They can eat if they want, but they don't need to eat, so it's sort of like they've lost their sense of taste over time. And the group kind of convinces them that, well, you know, maybe you should take some pride in your cooking and enjoy a good meal, even if you don't need it, because it's part of staying alive and staying connected with who you are. So they're hoping to rescue. They're hoping to defeat the lunatic magician and maybe rescue these people. As they go down further, they run into a griffin. And, he has a weird name. The dwarf Senshi. There we go. Senshi the dwarf is sort of their survivalist. He knows how to hunt and cook monsters. He has like a deep respect for nature and ecology. kind of like a wild man living off in the woods. However, he seems to be absolutely terrified of griffins for some reason. So after they, you know, have like a comedic, you know, tough situation where they've got it, the griffin picks him up and carries him off, and they have to do all kinds of like goofy magic stuff to rescue him. He starts to tell them his story, and Chilchuck, the cool-headed scoundrel of the group, has already noticed that Senshi's a bit weird. How does he know all this stuff about monsters? How long has he been living here? He talks about living here like he's been here 10 years and the dungeon's only got discovered 6 years ago. That's weird. So what we learn about Senshi is that he was part of a group of dwarves who found the dungeon independently by mining before anyone else found it and started poking around there. However, since they didn't know what they were doing, one by one, everybody in the group starts dying off. And Senshi at 37 is what a dwarf would consider a young boy still. Like, he doesn't have his beard yet. So some of the dwarves have a very protective attitude towards him. One of the dwarves kind of like resents him being there and thinks he's holding the group back. So it eventually gets to the point where they're starving to death. And what we learn is this is a really important thing for Senshi, for why he likes cooking creatures and being a survivalist. And he hates it if kids ever go hungry. He wants to feed all the kids because he himself nearly starved to death at one point in his life. And what he admits is that ever since he was a kid, one of the older dwarves cooked him something, and he claimed that he made him griffin soup, but he wasn't really sure if that's what he made him. So the question is, was it really griffin soup, or did his friend kill one of the other dwarves, and did he commit cannibalism? And this question has sort of been haunting him forever, and it's also one of the reasons why he's afraid of griffins. They were hunting him, and if he ever eats a griffin, he's going to know the answer to that question one way or the other. They make him griffin soup, and he says, "This doesn't taste anything like what I had back then." And Lyos suggests, "Well, what if it wasn't a griffin at all? What if it was a hippogriff? That would taste completely different, right?" Now, one of the neat things Ryoko Kui does is she sort of lampshades, you know, goofy things about fantasy and goofy things about, you know, sort of sitcom stories a lot. So after he suggests that, and Senshi says, "Oh yeah, maybe it was a hippogriff. Maybe I didn't really eat another human being." Then Lyos says, "Okay, let's go get a hippogriff and we'll feed you that." And everybody like freaks out and says, "What? You mean you weren't just gonna like leave it an open question? You actually want to go hunt a hippogriff?" So they go get some hippogriff meat, and when Senshi eats that, he realizes this really is what I ate. So I didn't commit cannibalism, something he was terrified of. He's freed of that fear, and he has kind of like a deep emotional experience where this plain soup that he ate when he was nearly starving to death was the best meal of his life, even though it wasn't very well cooked, and he always wanted to have it one more time, and he gets very emotional about it. So Senshi has a very deep personal connection to why he's a survivalist, why he actually loves animals and cares about animals, and why it's important to him to take food and nutrition seriously. In volume 8, there's some, you know, shenanigans where they wander into like a magic circle and everybody's race changes. So Senshi the dwarf becomes a beautiful elf. There's even like a page of what each character would look like as each of the other races, which again, it just shows how much thought Ryoko puts into things like their physical characteristics, like down to like gnomes have their ears higher up on their heads. Half-foots, basically hobbits, have more like the proportions and size of like teenage kids. So people might just assume they're a teenage kid version of a normal human being. Things like that. It's just a lot of sweet attention to detail. Hopping ahead, Lyos kind of like just has like a back and forth with everybody about how the group got together in the first place. And it was sort of haphazard. Like, there was never like a big plan. It was always just more like Lyos decided to go wandering around, and then he picked up his sister at the magic school. He was sort of mad at his village because they pick on his sister for being a magic user. So Lyos basically doesn't have a plan. His current plan is just, well, we're going to go stop the lunatic magician, and then I guess we'll do something to free Fallon from the curse of being a chimera. He doesn't really have a well thought out plan other than we're just going to try it and see what happens. What he reveals when he tells this story is that Fallon didn't have any friends as a child because of her ability to use magic, and she used to like make meals for people as a way of sort of showing love to them. And this is really meaningful to Marcel, because Marcel has always considered herself like a really good friend to Fallon, but she never knew that was something that, she never knew that about Fallon, that Fallon had no other friends and that Fallon made meals for people she liked. And suddenly she realizes Fallon used to make meals for me all the time, and that's what that meant. So there's this really great balance to Marcel where she's often the butt of a lot of jokes because she's really smart and really serious, and she keeps ending up in stupid situations where she has to make an idiot of herself, or she doesn't know how to survive that well on her own. But underneath that goofy side of her is also this extremely serious and intelligent side of her as well. It's a great balance. Their dumb plan is, wait a second, when we ate the dragon, how did the dragon get resurrected if we ate part of it? And Senshi explains, well, if you eat something, it's no longer part of what of the body it used to be. So if you eat part of the dragon meat and someone tries to resurrect the dragon, what you ate never goes back to the dragon. So their bright idea is, okay, well, the mistake we made is we left the dragon corpse lying around so it could get resurrected. What we need to do this time is we need to perform surgery to cut Fallon off the dragon, and then we need to eat the entire dragon so that no one can resurrect it. That's their brilliant plan to how they're going to fix this this dumb magical situation they've put themselves in. And Laios kind of realizes, well, wait a sec, we've made a whole bunch of friends. We've made friends with the orcs and the ghost monsters and all our old friends. They could help us eat the dragon. So what's being built up to is that Laios and Kabru would be two very different kinds of kings. Laios is kind of too stupid to be king, but he's very good-natured and compassionate towards people. Kabru has the intelligence to be the king, but he's also a manipulator and uses people like tools, and he desperately wants to be king. So should the king be the person who wants to be king, or should the king be the person who is hesitant to accept the power of being king? So the canaries also get fleshed out a bit more, and there's always this great pattern where they have great creative powers, but that's balanced with a great creative weakness. So I think his name is Fafnir, the captain of the canaries, is just an elite badass elf, but he only has one eye, which means he has no depth perception, and he doesn't have a good sense of direction. So he'll accidentally start walking in the wrong direction before someone corrects him. And Kabru notices that here's the leader of this elite group of elves who conquer and destroy dungeons. And he doesn't even know how to walk around a dungeon on his own. He's a powerful fighter, but he kind of needs the rest of the group to babysit him a bit and make sure he's pointing in the right direction before he starts kicking all kinds of ass. Now, when we see Fafnir fighting, this is a really great creative fight scene because you don't quite understand what he's doing at first, and later you figure out what he's doing. So Fafnir combines elite martial arts with advanced magic. So what everybody assumes he's doing is he must be turning everybody into stone with petrification magic, right? Every time he touches them, boom, they turn into stone. But for some reason, their heads or their body parts are disappearing. Why is that happening? Is he turning them into stone and slicing them with magic? You don't quite get what he's doing at first. And kind of like the theme of this is, until you understand how magic works, there are different ways to use magic to get the results. So it wasn't petrification magic at all. It was teleportation magic. And so the reason their faces are missing is that he's just teleporting them into stone walls and giving them room to breathe. So that means that not only is he capable of kicking around an entire troop of black market guys, he can even kick them around without killing any of them in the end. And that even means that because he's not killing them because it doesn't like plop them in a stone wall and then they die because they're inside a stone wall. It replaces them with the stone wall. And so when they pop into existence, the stone pops into the place where they were originally. Just like lots of great attention to detail and things like that. When Fafnir and Kabru encounter the lunatic magician, Fafnir basically toys with the lunatic magician. So this guy who's essentially the big evil boss of the entire dungeon, when he comes face to face with Fafnir, nearly gets himself killed. But remember, Kabru has his own agenda. He doesn't want the elves to conquer the dungeon on their own. So he pretends to grab Fafnir and give this epic speech about how the humans need to conquer this dungeon to prove their strength. He's just hoping the whole time that Fafnir is able to, the lunatic magician is able to get away and buy him some time. There's also this important plot point that the lunatic magician summons the chimera, Fallon, to save him, but she can't breathe up in the upper levels. It's like being a fish out of water. If you're a dragon, you need magic just to breathe and walk around. So if they can't heal Fallon, she's basically dead once the dungeon gets conquered. Chilchuck reveals that he once had a wife, and when Marcel questions him about it, he says, well, I cheated on her, and now I'm never going to see her again. Shut up and leave me alone. So later they run into a bicorn, which is sort of like an evil counterpart to a unicorn. Unicorns like young virgin women. So Laios concludes, well, if unicorns like young virgin women, then what we need to capture a bicorn is an old lecherous man. So Chilchuck, you cheated on your wife. Go capture that bicorn for us. And the bicorn turns on him and nearly rips his arm off. And what he admits is that when I said I cheated on my wife, I lied. She left me. I don't know why she left me. So that's something I say just because I don't feel like talking about it. So what they realize is that Chilchuck actually was a good husband. He's not as scoundrelish as he pretends to be. And he also admits that he didn't just have a daughter. He had three daughters. So it's like they're hidden. Because Chilchuck's a little hobbit, you forget that he's actually a fully grown man with all of this baggage and backstory to him. So he finally kind of like opens up and admits something about himself to the rest of the group, which is that he's the father of three grown girls. Volume 9 kind of like shifts the focus. So in volume 7 and 8, we mostly followed Laios's group. Volume 9 focuses on Kabru and Fafnir on their own. And there's even kind of like a neat framing device where when they show these two, there'll be like one joke panel where they'll show whatever ridiculous shenanigans the main group is getting up to. So it really helps you stay like focused on, okay, this is the time and place where this is going on. Great example of just like jumping back and forth in time and using just like a simple panel to keep everything straight without having to work too hard. So there's a little scene where we see how Marcel joined Laios's group, which is that she was extremely mad that Laios took his sister away from the magic school. And again, there's this theme that the elves look at humans as cute little kids. So Marcel is convinced that, you know, Fallon's way too young and sweet to be going on adventures. You dumbass. I'm going to save her and bring her back to school where she's supposed to be. And they had to convince Marcel to let Fallon stay part of the group. It's also a great way of underscoring how there's more to Marcel than just being a goof. She actually is a very serious elf magic user. But what eventually they do is because she has a nerdy interest in life and death magic, they convince her to stay and study the dungeon to see how the heck does the lunatic magician keep people from dying in the dungeon. So they sort of appeal to her inner nerd. Cat girl gets some more development. So she's very selfish. She's always out on her own. The entire group gets attacked by succubus insects. And it's discussed that the succubus aren't demons. The succubus are insects that are named after the demons because they also disguise themselves as what you would find most attractive as a way of sneaking up on you and sucking the life out of you. Marcel at one point mentions that the demons actually exist and they're not just legends, which hints that Marcel knows a lot more about demons and spiritual reality than she lets on in normal conversation. But that's just some foreshadowing for later. The succubus attack, and one by one they get taken out. Again, there's comedy. So when Marcel's succubus shows up, he's a long white-haired anime boy with an eye patch that says death on it and lectures her about being a naughty princess who ran away from the castle. So Chilchuck just cracks up because Marcel just has this horrible taste in men from her stupid romance novels. But the entire group gets taken out except for Catgirl. So Catgirl is convinced she's going to be fine because she doesn't love anybody. She figures, I don't need men. I don't like men. I don't like women. I'm going to be fine. But when a succubus appears to her, it appears to her in the form of her mother telling her that she loves her, which shocks her because she wasn't prepared for this. What we learn is that the cat girl was essentially raised in a cage like an animal and fed scraps from time to time. So she's never had anything like a loving parental influence in her life. So it seems like that's how the succubus are going to tempt her in, but somehow she's able to resist and fight back. And what she learns is that because she has a cat soul and a human soul, the cat soul is able to resist this, and that at some point a giant panther shows up as one of the succubi, and so she's the human part of her soul is able to resist that. So she thought she was so strong and able to resist, but it's actually kind of like a coincidence of her magical situation that is able to let her resist and fight fight back. There's also a neat thing where when she beats the succubus, she doesn't quite get how she was able to beat the succubus. She just tries a bunch of things and finally something works. She stumbles into their nests and throws their babies at them, and the succubus instantly go after their babies. She doesn't really get that's why it worked, but she just figures, I guess it worked, whatever. There's a really neat element that some characters are less intelligent than other characters, but in Catgirl's case, she's really good at kind of like naturally fighting and just trying a bunch of stuff. So even if she doesn't understand why something works, sometimes she just stumbles across what works. So this is all building up to the climax. And what I love about the climax this is building up to is there's essentially a debate about metaphysics. And both sides are doing something that makes total moral sense if what they believe about spiritual reality is true or not. So it's all going to come down to whether the god of the dungeon is like a benevolent, you know, kind of like divine angelic figure, or is the god of the dungeon a demonic figure that uses deception. So Lyos encounters the sort of lion-like god of the dungeon, and he kind of like tells him, it's prophesied that someone's going to rescue the people of this dungeon. I'd like it to be you, because you are compassionate to monsters. You are compassionate to orcs. If you became king, Lyos, you could actually create sort of a peaceful coexistence where monsters, you know, are allowed to exist. We don't exterminate them. We sort of raise them like farm animals, right? So yes, we no longer have monsters hunting us down, but we also coexist with monsters, and the orcs will be able to coexist with humans, right? So it's kind of like this almost idyllic vision of diverse cultures and oneness with nature if Lyos can become the king. However, Kabru and the elves believe that the dungeon is controlled by a demon. So if the lion god is a demon, that means he's just coming up with an inventive lie to lure Lyos in. So they're desperately trying to kill the demon and kill Lyos if necessary to stop him from becoming lord of the dungeon. So we have to get more background on Kabru. Kabru reminisces about being a kid, an orphan kid raised by an adopted elf mom after his village is destroyed. And again, his elf mom just sort of thinks it's adorable that he wants to go off and fight monsters and wants to protect him. But once he convinces her he's serious about it, she sort of changes her mind and says, okay, in that case, I'm going to be tough as heck on you and teach you the way of the sword. Years later, he wonders, should I have stayed safe in my bed in the elf kingdom? Never. He's happy with his decision to go out and fight monsters. Now, he and Fafnir have kind of like fallen through the cracks of the dungeon, deep into the dungeon. Fafnir, although he's an incredible fighter, has no ability to take care of himself, essentially. He's kind of like a big kid with these intense powers. I mark this because this is just such an inventive idea that it's almost like this is stereotypically a guy thing. And then I think Ryoko Kui's a female mangaka, but she gets like this guy stuff that I freaking love. So how did they survive the fall? Well, Fafnir uses teleportation magic. So all he does is he teleports them and then flips them upside down so that their downward momentum is turned into upward momentum, and then they fall down again. And he repeats that to slow the descent of their fall and break their fall. Just great, great creative stuff. So Fafnir finally tells Kabru his backstory. And this is a great framing device. This is a great example of the unreliable narrator. So Fafnir starts telling his story, and instantly Kabru realizes that this is way too complicated and there are way too many characters. And so this is illustrated visually. First three characters, and then four smaller characters, and then one small panel with like five characters, and then one teeny tiny little panel with eight characters. There's way too many characters for Kabru to follow. So Kabru retells the story to us. He says, I'm just going to simplify this, and it's just going to be about Fafnir and the others, and we don't really care much about who the others are. And Kabru keeps commenting on what a great story Fafnir has and how it's so good narratively. Later, when he retells his version of the story to Fafnir, Fafnir says, you're messing up all the details. That's not really how it happened. So the unreliable narrator is Kabru relating to us Fafnir's complicated story. This is also a great example of what if you have to have a whole bunch of complicated information to dump on someone? Well, one way to dump it on someone is to have someone else dumb it down and simplify it for us, even if they're acting as an unreliable narrator. So what Kabru learns is that the reason, why is Fafnir the head of this elite group of elves, made up of criminal elves who would have gotten the death penalty, but instead they serve their country by fighting on the badass Canary Squad, and the sons and daughters of noble elf families who just want to prove how manly and how committed they are to the elf kingdom. That's who the Canaries are, the baddest of the bad. Fafnir doesn't just have nicks on his ears to show he's a criminal. His ears are cut off, and we don't know what that means or why that is. So what's revealed is the reason he's the captain of the Canaries is he was once the lord of a dungeon himself, which means he understands how dungeon magic works and how dungeons are constructed, even though he can't really find his sense of direction or remember to feed himself without anybody babysitting him. So what we learn is that Fafnir was taken in by a sort of demonic force within a dungeon. The demon showed him a vision of how if he had never become an adventurer, he'd have married his true love. Instead, his older brother married his true love. Just let me grant your wish that you were never join the Canaries and you can have everything you want. So Fafnir makes his wish that he never join the Canaries. He seems to live this beautiful world where he's with his waifu. Also, it's noteworthy that the demon is a goat. So the demon is depicted just like sort of medieval depictions of Satan in a truly terrifying scene. The demon shows up to claim his prize, Fafnir. And Fafnir realizes that when the demon granted his wish, there was a condition that Fafnir didn't know about, which is that I get all of you. He tries to consume Fafnir, and Fafnir barely gets out alive. The demons exist by consuming the desires of living creatures, and it consumes all of his desire and all of his emotion and soul, except for his desire for revenge. It even consumes his will to live, and so his company assumes, well, if it's consumed his will to live, he's just going to die. But Fafnir, even without his will to live, has a desire to get revenge on the demon, and that's the one thing that keeps him alive now. He doesn't have a desire to eat, so people have to remind him to eat. He doesn't have a desire to live, but that revenge is keeping him going. He's almost like a dead man walking. So the thing this is all building up to, of course, is that Fafnir and Kabru, these incredibly intelligent and competent fighters, are pursuing Laios and his group. Once they meet Laios and his group, there's obviously going to be a 180 degree disagreement about what the heck they're supposed to be doing about the dungeon. Laios wants to make the dungeon his kingdom and have all the monsters live in coexistence with one another. Kabru and Fafnir are operating under the assumption that the dungeon is controlled by demons and we need to wipe it off the face of the earth, like scorched earth, sow salt on the ground when we're done so that nothing can grow here ever again. And both of these positions make sense if what they assume about the dungeon is true. So it's all coming down to a metaphysical argument. Who is right? Is the dungeon controlled by demons, or are the dungeons monsters, like kind of like living creatures who deserve a chance to live in peaceful coexistence with humans? I don't know. I want to find out what'll happen. All right, that's three volumes of Delicious in Dungeon. I'm number one Marmaduke fan. I love you guys. Catch you later.